Tonight on CTV News, Cup Day is looming and police have a strong warning. Trainers are preparing for one of the most important races of the year and NCEA students are back in exam mode.
Broadcasting across Canterbury, from the CTV studio, this is First at Five.
Good evening. Christchurch police are hoping they don't have to put up with drunken behaviour seen at the Melbourne Cup last week. A heavy police presence is expected at tomorrow's Cup Day, as Marcus Gibbs explains.
Canterbury police will be out in force next week, especially on Cup Day. Cup and Joe Week is traditionally one of the busiest of the year for police, as people from around the country congregate in the city to take part in the annual week of celebrations. Inspector Peter Cooper says Canterbury Police's focus is to help ensure the week is safe and enjoyable for everyone. He says there will be a visible police presence at events and locations across the city. He says extra staff will be working to cope with the busy schedule of races and events. Alcohol makes up a third of all crime reported annually in New Zealand, and police will be targeting drink driving and preventing alcohol-related disorder. Inspector Cooper says anyone celebrating should plan their days and nights and be sensible with alcohol. Police will be actively enforcing liquor bans, and anyone caught breaching the bans will be arrested. An additional liquor ban will also be in place from 9 a.m. to 10 p.m. in the streets surrounding Addington Raceway during the New Zealand Trotting Cup Day. Inspector Cooper says the day is 20% busier than an average Tuesday and police receive and respond to almost the same number of call-outs as they do on a typical Saturday night. Last year, recorded offences on Cup Day were significantly down when compared to previous years. Alcohol and traffic-related offending continue to feature in call-outs. Burglars historically target homes during Cup and Show Week. Police are urging Canterburyans to make sure valuables are out of sight.
And it's an anxious wait for a top local vet ahead of the biggest day on the racing calendar. It's hoped the horses remain in good health following the race.
Cup and Show Week has kicked off, and before tomorrow's races, local trainer Anna Furlong is making sure her two horses are in the best possible shape.
Training's going well. It's been months of, you know, in the making, but we're just about there. A couple weeks finally arrived.
It's a big week for trainers and jockeys. Serious money is up for grabs, so extra care is spent on these top contender horses.
A lot of time and effort goes into getting them ready, you know, massages and, you know, physio appointments.
But in the back of this trainer's mind is the sad scene that unfolded on Tuesday when Melbourne Cup favourite Admire Recti collapsed and died after his race. Anna's concerned it could happen this week if the crowd gets too out of hand.
It obviously wasn't the horse's fault or the handler's fault or anything. It's the people, you know, that get a bit boozy and want to have a good time and lean over the rail and yahoo, and that can cause a bit of a problem. But
Corin Murford is a resident vet at the races. He says it's a rare thing for a horse to collapse after a race, but not unheard of.
I can recall two horses in the last 2 years that have died during a race, and both of those have been hemorrhage.
What's frightening is that a horse can seem fine, only to die during or after a race.
I would say there'd be no show if picking that up earlier. We often see horses which will race and they'll fade out the back for some reason or not, and they can be perfectly or appear perfectly healthy before the race. It may have had an underlying condition before the race.
A lot of money and time is invested in a horse. It can be a traumatising experience for everyone involved.
There's a lot of money invested in these horses, and of course a lot of these good stallions have stud potential afterwards, so it's the last thing an owner wants, and a trainer or anybody wants, to happen.
At least 50 horses are kept at Riccarton Raceway before the race week gets underway. The horses have a few quiet days following busy months of serious training.
Well, these horses have been in training for several months before they go to trials, which is a bit like a race day, but there's no betting and more of an education. And they'll be worked every day, and they have galloping days, usually a Tuesday and a Thursday. So these horses are properly conditioned for the racing.
All winners are tested for drugs, but in Christchurch, the testing hasn't been an issue for many years.
But it's only not a problem because Racing Integrity Unit are doing a jolly good job in making sure that it's not a problem.
As one of the vets working at both Addington and Riccarton Raceways, Corin Murford is hoping nothing goes wrong with the horses.
If we do nothing, it's a good race day. That's exactly right.
And Anna has her fingers crossed that her horses remain in perfect shape before their races next week. Marcus Gibbs, CTV News.
Firefighters say it's a miracle a truck driver trapped for over 3 hours escaped without serious injuries. Emergency services were called to the incident on Main North Road just before the Ashley River Bridge around 5:30 this morning. It's believed he missed the bridge and careered off the road and took out a large tree. Woodend Chief Fire Officer Murray Lamb says it was a tricky job getting the truckie out of the crushed cab and says it was the worst looking accident he's ever attended. He says the man is lucky to be alive. No doubt about that. Well, for a third year in a row, the Hororata Highland Games has attracted thousands of spectators. The local take is the biggest event on the year's calendar, with money raised going back into the community. Well, still to come here on CTV News, employers are being told to clean up their act when it comes to workplace safety.
Kickoff is pure football heaven, featuring all the games, the goals, the interviews, and the stats. Kickoff, Sunday at 1:30 p.m. right here on CTV. The world really is your oyster with farm-to-farm tours. Discover some of the world's best farming, scenery, and cultural experiences. We work closely with trusted international colleagues in more than 30 countries to customise great trips for people just like you. For a hassle-free trip, call the friendly team at Farm to Farm Tours now or visit our website.
Blackwall's has a proud history presenting leading vehicle brands, extensive backup and service for a total one-stop driving experience. Holden, Mazda and HSV new and used vehicle sales, servicing, parts, paint and panel, Isuzu truck sales and service, all together in one convenient location. More selection, more value, more quality and more reasons to make Blackwall's your number one choice. Visit Blackwall's today, corner Waterloo Racecourse Road, Sockburn or online at blackwalls.co.nz.
Kids Television is right here on CTV. With an exciting range of kids programming, join in on all the fun, Saturday 7 a.m. to 8:30 a.m. right here on CTV.
Thousands of school children around the country knuckled down for the start of the NCA exams today. The annual examination will test the students on a year's worth of learning in a range of subjects.
No time left to cram. These students are about to start their first exam.
Are you feeling nervous?
Yeah, very.
Exhausted. That ready?
Hornby High School is one of hundreds of schools around the country taking part in the annual NCEA senior school examinations.
They're sort of putting the cream on top of their NCEA pile of credits.
This morning, more than 39,000 pupils sat their level one NCEA science exam, including about 50 from Hornby High School.
Scary. You don't know what's going to happen.
Some of the students claim to have been up all night studying.
Yeah, a solid 2 hours every day, I'd imagine.
The seniors finished school last week, and then the prospect of exams became very real.
And since then, there have been extra sort of study sessions with the teachers. Many of the students were back in here on Friday, and we would expect that over the next few weeks that they will be coming in to work with their teachers for that last-minute cramming.
Later in the day, smaller groups sat geography, chemistry, agriculture, and horticultural science, history and Japanese exams. Level 1 English will be held on Wednesday. More than 47,000 students will sit this exam.
It's all a bit new. We try to give them practice with school exams earlier in the year. And even back in year 9 and year 10, they would have sat exams in the auditorium, so they have had some experience of it, but this is the first real one. Yep.
It's crucial their students not only do their best, but do well.
I don't want to be a failure, and in the future, you know, I'd like to have a good job.
Last year, around 80% of Hornby's students passed NCEA Level 1. The school's happy with that result, but would still like it to improve.
Just helping the students get over the line in terms of, you know, study tips and working through the courses with them.
In total, 143,000 pupils from around the country are sitting NCEA and scholarship exams over 3 weeks. There are more than 120 exam sessions running this year. It's going to be a very busy time. Marcus Gibbs, CTV News.
There's a call for employers to clean up their act when it comes to keeping workers safe on the job. Unions say New Zealand workers are getting a raw deal and too many have died on the job, as Marcus Gibbs explains.
CTU Vice President Richard Wagstaff is concerned that port companies are trying to weaken and undermine recommendations being made for the bill. He says port companies have complained that expanded duties in the bill are too onerous in the industry, given the widespread use of contractors. However, the union says the country's ports' health and safety records are an illustration of why these recommendations are absolutely essential. The union believes that the 7 deaths and 133 serious accidents since 2011 for a total ports workforce of 4,000 shows why the status quo is unacceptable. Wagstaff highlights Lyttelton Port, which has gone on the record to say that the company isn't responsible for 2 out of the 3 deaths at the port in the last year, as the workers were not port employees. Yesterday, the union told Parliament's Transport and Industrial Relations Committee that New Zealand workers deserve the best law possible. The union says the Health and Safety Reform Bill contains several important measures, such as stronger duties on directors of companies, shared responsibilities for companies that share a workplace, greater powers for health and safety representatives, and stronger enforcement measures.
Well, imagine donating blood or plasma more than 100 times. Hard to imagine, isn't it? Well, what about 300 times? Well, one Christchurch woman is trying that. She was one of the first to donate blood to the new Christchurch Blood Centre when it opened today, Marcus Gibbs reports.
What is it about blood that makes people queasy? We all have it and may urgently need more some point in our lives. The new blood centre in Christchurch is like a giant blood bank. Refrigerators hold a fresh supply, and in this room it's literally on tap. Leslie is in the hot seat today, ready to do her bit to help Cantabrians. If she doesn't look nervous, that's because it's not her first time doing this. The 66-year-old has donated plasma and blood more than 290 times. Today is her 293rd, but it's her first at the new blood centre.
I thought giving blood would be more complicated than it is, but it was good, so I just kept on doing it.
The Health Minister Jonathan Coleman opened the building just 2 hours earlier, and soon Leslie joined a few other brave people, some milestone donors like her, others complete newbies. This new modern facility is much different to the one she visited during her first donation in the 1970s.
I was in a little old house in Cashel Street when I first started, and it was a bit cramped, and this is always very friendly and nicer.
This purpose-built centre will play a vital role as one of the New Zealand Blood Service's 2 main facilities. It comprises a blood donor centre, manufacturing and testing laboratories, and specialised storage for blood. In the case of a major catastrophe in Auckland, Cantabrians could be called upon to donate. Up to 19 people can roll up an arm in here at any one time. Every month, Christchurch needs 292 donors to keep up with the constant demand for blood. However, just 2.3% of those eligible to donate in Christchurch do so.
Once their needle's in, it's really quite comfortable and it's over very quickly, and potentially you're saving up to 3 people's lives.
This centre is one of 7 around the country where plasma donations can be made. 4,688 plasma donors donate every year. However, the New Zealand Blood Service needs an additional 3,000 to meet the projected demand for next year.
Plasma is the part of your blood that carries your antibodies and carries your red cells around. And so some of the products that we can make can be things like hepatitis B, can give short-term immunity for a patient, tetanus, hepatitis A, anti-D, so lots and lots of those products.
So what inspires someone to be so generous to help others by donating blood or plasma?
Well, it doesn't bother really, it's just half an hour or so. Every couple of weeks for me.
Becoming a donor can be a humbling feeling.
One of the nurses told me the other week that somebody had to have an astronomical number of units of plasma, and I thought, well, that's great, you know.
How helping to save that person.
Well, hopefully.
Blood is always in hot demand, and the new campaign Lend an Arm hopes to inspire new donors to help save more lives. Marcus Gibbs, CTV News.
Well, sort of come on CTV News, a Northwest band has got plenty of cash, but where are its members?
Hi, I'm Jude Kirk. Join me weekdays for Let's Go Shopping.
Espresso Car Wash. Bring back the shine with options from an express wash for just $28 up to a fully detailed interior and exterior grooming package from just $63. We also offer services such as interior shampoo, wax and polish, aircon treatment, odour eliminator, vehicle de-stickering, the list goes on. And don't forget our gift vouchers, no matter what the occasion. Espresso Car Wash at 5 great Christchurch locations. Corner Lincoln Road and Morehouse Ave, The Palms, Northlands, Ferrymead and The Hub Hornby.
Come on down to Ferrymead Golf. Care for a game of paintball? How about some swings on the old driving range? Or on our par 3 9-hole golf course? Test your skills on the mini golf course or have a go at the air gun shooting range. Then relax at the Whale Cafe with one of our super succulent Whale Burgers. Whether you want to perfect your swing or are looking for a fun family day out, come down to Ferrymead Golf, 50 Ferrymead Park Drive, right next to the Ferrymead Heritage Park.
Avoid the monkeys when it comes to relocating. Trust A1 Movers, a family business since 1993 that guarantees a professional job every time. We carefully handle and wrap your valued items, ensuring they have a safe journey. Secure storage and insurance options are also available.
A1 Movers, the careful, caring moving company. Oi!
The mission statement of Red and Black Sport is always to bring a voice to achievers in sport, be it Canterbury, New Zealand or internationally. We'll continue to do that here on CTV with Red and Black Sport. Don't miss it every week.
Welcome back to CTV News. Well, a local brass band is hoping a grant from the Christchurch City Council will attract more teenagers. But will it actually work?
Sylvia Vale's been playing brass since she was young, and earlier this year she joined the Norwest Brass Band, one of many young teens flocking to join the musical ensemble. No longer just for the military or Christmas parades, people from different ages and all walks of life are taking up an instrument, and the Norwest Brass Band is no exception.
Well, we started in February after last year I talked to one of my friends and he had a couple of pupils at Burnside High that didn't have a brass band to play in this area. When we thought about it, we thought, well, there aren't any bands, and we talked to the high schools and they were saying there's really not much brass players coming through, so we thought, no, we can fix that.
Since February, the band has grown in popularity, with different age groups and members of the community hosting concerts and entertainment evenings.
Anyone, we have people from all walks of life, which is quite fun. We have teachers, we have an undertaker at my band, I'm an engineer, we have people from the army, musicians, but anyone really, it just brings people from different walks of life together with a common interest.
The band's director is hoping an open evening will encourage others to take up an instrument. Earlier this year they received a grant from the Christchurch City Council to help buy 4 new instruments, giving beginners a chance to learn for free. Emma Cropper, CTV News.
Gordon's here now with a look at the weekend sports roundup.
The Canterbury Kings completed the double over the weekend to be a perfect 3 wins from 3 in the domestic 2020 cricket competition. The Kings weekend got off to a bright start on Friday night with an 8-wicket win over defending champion Northern Districts. Andrew Ellis was the chief destroyer for the Kings, with 4 for 28 off his 4 overs, doing his part in restricting the Knights to 146. Canterbury's innings got off to a steady start, with Ronnie Hearer knocking a quick 20 off 14, before Neil Broome contributed with 37 from 42 deliveries. Aussie import Aidan Blizzard steered the Kings' inning to success, finishing the job off with 2 overs remaining as he hit an unbeaten 69. On Saturday, the Kings took on Wellington, and yet again it was Ellis getting the job done with the ball, this time recording figures of 5 for 14, the best T20 figures in Canterbury history and the third best at New Zealand domestic level. Chasing Wellington's total of 110, the Kings were kept honest, losing 5 wickets on their way to the win, with captain Peter Fulton unbeaten on 45 as the team completed the perfect weekend of cricket. The Kings now have 2 home games at Hagley Oval to look forward to, starting on Thursday afternoon with a rematch against Northern Districts. To football now, where Southern United defeated the Canterbury United Dragons 1-0 on Saturday, giving the Dunedin-based side their first win at English Park since 2009. The only goal of the game came in the 35th minute when George Milne completed a quick counter-attack move following a Canterbury mistake. Meanwhile, it was better fortunes for our women's side, the Mainland Pride, who claimed a 3-0 win over previously top of the table Waikato Bay of Plenty. Monique Barker got the home side off to the perfect start with an early goal before doubling the lead in the 16th minute. The win was completed by Amy Phillips, who completed the scoring midway through the second half as the Pride now move to top of the table. They share lead with Auckland. Saturday saw the second day of the latest round in the 2-day Metro cricket competition, with East Shirley grabbing an emphatic 10-wicket win over previously undefeated Sydenham. Tim Muir was the standout performer for East Shirley, picking up figures of 8 for 31. Burnside West University also had a 10-wicket win, picking up the points against Old Boys Collegians. After finishing off the Collegians' tail order early in the day, Burnside West needed just 5 overs to get the 16 required in their second innings. Ben McCord was the star for Lancaster Park Woolston as they got a 10-wicket win of their own, with McCord claiming 6 for 33 in the second innings to finish with match figures of 11 for 49 as his side defeated Riccarton. And in the weekend's other match, St Albans grabbed the narrowest of wins, getting up over Marist Harewood by just 1 wicket. Trailing by 67 after the first innings, Marist posted a second innings total of 181 to set Saints a total of 116 for victory. Tom Meyrick took an impressive 4 for 26, but it didn't prove to be enough, as St Albans did just enough to get the runs required. And finally tonight, it's a big day in Canterbury tomorrow, with the New Zealand Trotting Cup taking place at Addington. The racing starts from 12:05 with the Christchurch Casino New Zealand Cup race at 5:15. Also in the region tomorrow is a treat for motorsport fans. The Silver Fern Endurance Rally stops in town, with the cars in Parc Fermé at the Palms tonight. Drivers will take on 5 special stages around Banks Peninsula tomorrow before 2 special stages between Geraldine and Timaru finish off the day. You're up to date with the latest in local sport. I'm Gordon Finlater for CTV Sport.
Thank you, Gordon. Well, it's looking like a windy rest of the week. Here's Emma with the region's weather forecast.
Looking first at Timaru, Temuka and Geraldine, they hit a high of 19. Methven, Ashburton and Rakaia got up to 20 degrees today. Mild weather for Darfield, Leeston and Rolleston, hitting a high of 19. Looking at Lincoln and Christchurch, they hit a high of 19 degrees. Over in Akadawa, hope you've been outside enjoying the sunshine with a high of 19. Heading north, Rangiora, Kaipui and Amberley hit 20 degrees today. Further north, with the high of the region, was Culverton, Hamner Springs and Cheviot on 21. Kaikoura sat on 21 degrees today. But what about tomorrow? In Timaru, thick high cloud all day with gusty northwesterly winds. Strong for a time but decreasing and becoming cooler during the afternoon. Hitting 11 degrees overnight with a high of 17. In Ashburton, a fine and windy Tuesday ahead with gusty northwesterlies and plenty of high cloud. A low of 11 and expect a high of 18. Christchurch for all those race goers at Cup Day tomorrow. It will be fine with high cloud and sunny periods, as well as gusty northwesterlies, becoming strong around the middle of the day, then dying out during the evening. Temperatures will become cooler as the day goes on. Expect 11 degrees overnight and a high of 18 throughout your day. Strong northwesterlies are expected in Kaikoura, with high cloud and temperatures becoming cooler as the day continues. 11 degrees overnight with a high of 18 throughout your day. And in other areas around the region, Temuka and Geraldine can expect a high of 17 and low of 11. Methven and Rakai expect some cloud throughout the day, reaching a high of 17 degrees. Darfield, Leeston and Rolleston, 11 degrees overnight with a high of 18 throughout the day. Looking at Lincoln, cloudy periods throughout the day, reaching a high of 18 degrees. Akadawa expect a high of 18 degrees tomorrow. As long as I got you. Rangiora, Kaipui and Amberley, cloud periods throughout the day with a high of 18. Culverton, Hamner Springs and Cheviot expect a high of 17 for your Tuesday. And looking at the coming days for Canterbury, dry at first on Wednesday with light winds and cool temperatures. Expect periods of cloud during the morning. There are a few scattered light showers possible during the afternoon with colder southwesterly winds freshening. Also a period of heavier showers during the evening with the possibility of thunderstorms or hail. On Thursday expect cloud with scattered showers and fresh to strong cold southwesterly winds. But the good news is those showers are expected to clear at night. Fine weather is expected for Friday with cool northeasterly winds and increasing high cloud. Expect some mild northwesterlies freshening from the evening. Strong to near gale northwesterlies on Saturday with warm temperatures and high cloud. A change to strong cold northwesterlies and showers later in the afternoon, but then clearing by the evening. Mostly fine and sunny on Sunday with moderate northeasterly winds expected. And that's all for your region's weather this Monday.
Thanks, Emma, and don't forget to check out all the stories that CTV provides you every weeknight. Head to ctv.co.nz. You can check out all the links via YouTube. And that is CTV News this Monday. Have a great night.
Supporting local content so you can see more of New Zealand on air.